really honored to be starting the session in this European EdTech Network, and especially honored also to be introducing Nick Madam, a Chief Learning Officer that personally is a mentor to me and professionally is a person with an amazing background in learning and development, and something that I is deeply benefiting from. And he has also huge experience from consulting firms as McKinsey and Deloitte for many years, taking the top roles on them. So Nick Madam, he will be talking about the big picture in EdTech and how is the global market. So Nick, the floor is yours.
Okay, thanks Christina for the kind words and for the introduction and for inviting me for this session today. You know, we are with a relatively small group, and that's wonderful. I know the session will be recorded, so people can listen to it at a convenient time. And what we do today is I will give a presentation. It would be wonderful if you could use the chat to share any thoughts you have, any comments you have, any questions you have, and we will have enough time at the end to have a discussion about this topic. You know, for context, in terms of, you know, myself, why I'm talking about EdTech today, Christina mentioned my background. I'm part of IE. I'm at the board. I'm Chief Learning Officer and also heading our Center for Corporate Learning Innovation, where we do research, where we share insights through publications, through webinars. And this is focusing on typically the corporate L&D world. In addition to this, I'm also a full professor at Nyan Rhodes University and also at an associate professor at UPenn, the Graduate School of Education. I'm on an advisory board and I'm a faculty member of an executive doctorate program for people who'd like to become chief learning officers for large, you know, corporates, profit and non-profit organizations. A very exciting program that has become very popular globally. I've been in this space, human capital development, learning and development for quite some time. Published a number of books related to, you know, the broader field of the learning sciences and leadership development. But one book I like to share, it's a book that I published in 2003. So that's now 17 years ago, the e-learning field book. And for those of you who have been in this field for quite some time, and we look back actually almost, you know, 17 years, it is fascinating what has happened, and particularly this year, you know, universities, schools, but also corporations have made a big shift when it comes to, you know, what I refer to more as digital learning in our field. So very exciting. I've been with Deloitte in the United States in a global role as Chief Learning Officer, responsible for learning and leadership development for the 250,000 people at Deloitte. I've also been at McKinsey, my last role, responsible for same learning and leadership development for McKinsey consultants and partners globally. And finally, I have a foundation for children related to EdTech, and I will share a couple of thoughts on that at the end of this presentation. But that gives you kind of a little bit context for today. So what I like to do is to talk about a couple of things. One is at a high level, just reflect on the market of education and EdTech. Then I will zoom in on two different segments of the market. One is the corporate and executive education market. Secondly, on the graduate education market. And then briefly, I will share some thoughts about policies related to EdTech. And then we have the Q&A. And again, please feel free to use the chat room for any questions you have. So let me start with the big picture in terms of education. And the big picture of education is that the education market is a huge market globally with a number of different segments. The global OPM market, with a lot of services for organizations on learning and development, the global online higher education market, the global higher education market, and then overall the global education market. And if you look at this, you know, overall, we talk about over the next 5 years, 7.8 trillion market. And if you look at the online market, the online degree market is one of the fastest growing markets. It will be 74 billion by 2025. So this is a huge market. There's so much going on in education around the world. And of course, this is driven by a number of factors. One, obviously, is growth of population, right? So if you look at how many people we have on the planet and how many people we have in over the next 10, 20, 30 years, we still expect a significant increase in number of people. That's one. Secondly, there is also a growth when it comes to attendance of secondary education and post-secondary education. And you see the numbers here. You know what this will look like. So that means, you know, there are more people to be educated globally. And as we all know, there are tremendous challenges when it comes to education at different segments of this this pie. You know, one big theme is a shortage of teachers globally. There is a shortage of schools globally, and you know what we have experienced this year. Of course, it's a very unusual situation that basically a lot of children and students did not have an opportunity to go to school because the schools have been closed. And a growing number of children and students have taken advantage of online education. So I think that's wonderful. Although I think all of us would admit that the quality of all the education is not necessarily at any place at the right level because of many reasons, because of pedagogy, because of the quality of the content, because of the access to the digital content. So there are many, many reasons. But at the same time, I'm also, I think it's wonderful and exciting that we have seen that so many children and students have been benefiting from online education. And also we have made a significant transformation when it comes to upscaling faculty, teachers around the world in becoming familiar with digital learning platforms. So very exciting. But then, you know, just focusing briefly on the EdTech market. So this is an extraordinary year for the EdTech market. If you look at how much venture capital has been put into education technology, it has gone through the roof. And as you see on this bar, you know, interesting, China and the United States are, you know, very big players when it comes to EdTech investments. Also, if you look at the valuation of companies around the world, a number of them has gone through the roof. You know, if the platform today, Zoom, you know, Zoom is worth more than a number of airline companies together. And that's kind of telling in terms of, you know, what's happening from a collaboration perspective, from a working perspective, from a learning perspective, when it comes to EdTech. And of course, there's also a lot that we have been learning over the last 8 months when it comes to, you know, what is effective from a technology perspective when we think about learning, and what are some of the challenges. And as you probably have experienced this yourself, Zoom is a wonderful platform, and also Microsoft Teams. And they have never been designed necessarily for education teaching purposes. So therefore, you know, there are a lot of features and functions that we are missing. And there are already a number of startups who are jumping into the space. One, I think, exciting startup is Class for Zoom. You might look them up if you are not familiar with them. It's basically an integration with Zoom that provides, you know, very exciting features and functions when it comes to teaching online. Now, I think if we look ahead, we think about the next 1, 2, 3 years, I anticipate an explosion of new technologies, edtech technologies, platforms, content that can be used for different segments of the market. So what we view today as an exciting platform, you know, in 3 years from now, 2 years from now, you know, what we have in place will look very differently and it will be an amazing experience. Now, if you take, you know, again, you step back and say even a bigger look at the ad tech market, well, you see here actually that this is exploding. And this the numbers I showed here were before we got experience, you know, we got exposed to the pandemic. So based on that, I would say, you know, the numbers are probably still underestimated, because the digital transformation, the learning transformation that we are going through will even become way more significant than and the numbers than we see on this slide today. There's a difference in terms of self-paced learning, instructor-led learning, or asynchronous learning, but you see that both segments are growing fast. And then in terms of the number of players, you know, this is an visual, what shows, you know, basically an overwhelming number of, you know, companies around the world. And of course, this map is even not complete. It's far from complete. But basically, I want to include this slide because it will show us on different segments of ed tech. You know, well, there are a number of different segments when it comes to knowledge and content and education management and experiential learning, et cetera, and assessments. But also there are so many parties, so many companies involved in this space. So that's also very promising, because if we look ahead, there's a tremendous need for advancing education, is my point of view, by using technologies. So that's kind of as a kind of the overall umbrella, right? So in terms of a growing population, huge investments in ed tech, many players around the world. So this is an extraordinary time to be in the ed tech space. Now I like to talk about, you know, corporates and learning and executive education, and I will start again with a little bit the context for ed tech in the corporate and executive education. And then I will show a number of examples. So first, this is a report from McKinsey, and I'm still affiliated with the firm as an external senior advisor and as a faculty member. And McKinsey published a report in June this year. It's called The Future of Jobs in Europe. And according to this report, McKinsey expects that almost one out of three jobs in Europe will be at risk over the next decade because of a combination of the pandemic and the digital revolution, or, you know, what has been referred to as the fourth industrial revolution, where companies, organizations will start using all kinds of new technologies that will have a huge impact on work, what we do, and also the future of jobs. So one out of three jobs will change. Now, if you look at this at a global level, and using also some statistics and reports from the World Economic Forum, globally, over 1 billion people need to be upskilled. And a lot of people need to be reskilled. So basically, you know, getting ready for a very different role, because their existing role will just not exist anymore over the next 5 or 10 years. So we have a huge challenge and opportunity to educate, to upskill and reskill basically, you know, every single person, you know, in the workforce on different competencies. Now, there's no time today to dig in deeper in terms of what are the competencies, etc. But just this for context, why this is so important. Now, if you look at the market of corporate education, it's a huge market, and there are a lot of different parties involved in this. Of course, a combination of ed tech companies, business schools, management consultants, training and development vendors. So a lot of different players are involved in this market to help to educate people who are working in organizations. And from an edtech perspective, there are a number of different segments actually of this work. There are a number of platforms, learning, what was called in the past, learning management platforms. Now we're referring to them as learning experience platforms, platforms for content delivery. A lot of content delivered, micro learning. So then a lot of assessment tools, VR, virtual reality, content libraries, a lot of corporations like Cross Knowledge and Udacity, Coursera, they have developed a lot of content and they were making them available externally. Then there are a number of tools for in the workflow, content platforms integrated with LMS platforms. And then I refer here also to a learning record store. So a lot of different segments of the edtech market. And now what's happening actually in this market? This market has changed, similar to other segments of the education market kind of overnight. Many business schools and professional training institutes, they have built over the last decades of particularly, quite a bit of digital learning, virtual learning, live virtual classrooms. But over the last 8 months, everybody has switched completely online. So you can take today, many kind of, executive education programs from all leading institutions around the world using, online formats. And also from an IE perspective, just to give you a flavor of these examples, we also have developed at IE a number of executive education programs which are available online. They are branded as the high impact online learning programs. And you see here a number of different topics that people can take these programs largely as a self-paced learning supported by a level of sub-tutoring and also potentially with a few live virtual sessions as part of the program. But to a large extent, it's all self-paced learning. Another big trend is that it's a term that I used in my book in 2003 in the e-learning field book is blended learning. And, at that point in time, it was a kind of a relatively new term. And although it has been around for 17 years, what I see is that this is the time that organizations, L&D functions, vendors, are really start doubling down on blended learning. Now, blended learning, from a definition perspective, there are many different ways to look at blended learning. The traditional initial definition was that blended learning is a combination of a digital learning component and the classroom. But I would argue that today, this is much broader. Blending means blending different formats and turn that into a learning journey. And of course, that can include a physical classroom, but it does not have to include a physical classroom. It can also be just, a number of virtual content platforms, assessments, virtual classrooms that are all blended together in a learning program. So blended can be completely digital or blended can be digital and the physical classroom. Earlier this year, I've worked on a report on corporate learning and have been in touch with leading organizations, government, non-government, larger organizations, a little bit mid-sized organizations, but all global organizations to a large extent. And, you know, basically collected feedback from the executives in learning and leadership development regarding what's happening, what are your priorities, but also the question, what will happen after COVID-19 when it comes to learning and development? And, you know, just showing you a couple of insights here. Obviously, everybody has moved virtual. Initially, companies started postponing programs, but then they realized that, okay, this is not about, you know, in May, everything is done. You know, this we might be in this a little bit longer. And guess what? Indeed, we will be in this situation longer. And therefore, many organizations have completely gone online. And what they expect that, you know, we will never go back to what we were used to. The future of executive education will be blended, will be digital, will be way more agile when we have to do and working with less people to get things done. And also the CLOs and executives, they shared with me that they will work in the future more with partners like universities, business schools, and other professional training providers, ed tech companies, who can help them to support their specific needs in building people capabilities in their organizations. So very exciting. Now, if you would ask me, Nick, you know, from a corporate L&D perspective, where are we currently from an ed tech perspective? And I have to say that, of course, that depends a little bit by organization, by industry, by country, because there's always a cultural component as well as part of learning and development. It also depends on where people are in their careers. If they're just joining a company, have they been around for quite some time? But overall, if you look at the number of formal learning hours, is about 35 globally, 35 learning hours per person globally. Now, again, there's a variation. The variation is from, you know, from obviously from zero to about 70, 80 hours. But at this point, about 50% of formal learning in the larger corporations is all done virtually. And even for some large corporations, it's 80 to 90%. That means that already a lot of change has happened over the last 17 years when it comes to moving towards digital. But obviously, looking ahead, you know, and beyond COVID, this will even, you know, become more important than ever before. Okay, so my last section, the second segment I like to talk about is the graduate education market. Because also in higher education, we have noticed a lot of change over the last decade, and particularly if we look ahead. One is obviously the MOOCs, the massive open online courses. You know, you might be familiar with a number of the different players in this market, like Udemy, edX, Coursera. And Coursera, of an edX as a nonprofit organization, was launched in 2012, collaborating with universities around the world. And if you see on this slide, you know, this has gone through the roof. Initially, you know, a number of people have been, you know, and also for the right reason, have been critical and said, well, you know, is this what is needed? But also, do we believe that people will complete their courses, how to keep them engaged, how to design highly impact courses based on insights from the learning sciences? So there are, you know, many challenges when it comes to online education. But guess what? You know, a lot has been learned over the last decade. And also because of, you know, analytics and big and data, you know, data. You know, we know a lot actually about the user experience and the user behaviors when people are going online. So this is very interesting. You know, a couple of examples. You know, this is just a Coursera who has been collaborating with you know, leading schools around the world on completely full online programs. Now you see a couple of examples here on the slide, you know, fantastic programs in computer science, data science, and entrepreneurship, business administration. And, you know, what we see is that they are gaining way more, interest globally. Another example, edX launched their micro bachelor programs where people can basically take a number of courses and they count or they are stackable for a bachelor degree. And again, you know, offered by leading universities from around the world. And this is a tremendous opportunity for people to, you know, to upskill themselves. And of course, from an IE perspective, IE has been also involved in edtech training for quite some time, as I mentioned. And that means we have a lot of online programs, blended programs. I shared with you the high-impact online programs. We have collaborated with Coursera in building MOOCs and also developed a number of online assets. And beyond that, if you see the timeline since 2003, from developing of digital material, study material, cases, simulations, MOOCs, and our global online MBA program is a flagship program when it comes to online education. It has been ranked very highly, the first and second slots by the Financial Times, and number one by QS. So an exciting program. And what we see, of course, also this year is that the number of people are interested in a program like that are growing. But also, I think already an interesting shift when it comes to the graduate programs. Currently at IE, about 70% of all the master programs, you see a whole list here as just as examples, have become blended programs. Some of them are also part-time programs, but they're all blended programs. So basically supporting the needs for students who are more and more working or have a part-time role or involved in parenting, part-time parenting, and therefore a blended program will fit perfectly their specific and unique needs when it comes to graduate education. And this is just an example of the global online MBA, as I mentioned. It's a program where we have people from all over the world. If you look on the right side of the screen, you know, what is the experience that people have? Well, on Saturdays, they have virtual classrooms. And then they work interactively in forums. And then simultaneously, they also are involved in individual or teamwork, team assignments. So they collaborate, and this is, makes it a very powerful learning experience for them. And from a technology perspective, the last few slides on that is that IE has already invested early in the game in building its own technology platform. One is our WOW studio in Madrid. It's a studio with a lot of screens where you have the professor, the facilitator, presenting to, and group of students around the world and executives. And what's powerful about this platform or this studio is there are a number of exciting features and functions. One is that we can see if people are really engaged and are they participating. And as a consequence, as a faculty member, you can point to people who have been less engaged in a lecture, but very powerful. We also have developed a desktop version of this platform, where on the left side, you see, of course, the students. And for those of you who are familiar with the Zoom platform, you know that there are, if you use Zoom for teaching, you have to go back and forth to your desktop a number of times when you have to share videos, when you have to share documents. And on this, faculty portal or faculty instance, you see actually that as a faculty member, you have basically on one screen access to all the features, functions that are important. So an exciting platform. So finally, and then we go to the Q&A. You know, if we reflect on the world of education and edtech, what are some of the key things to keep in mind? Well, first is that, as I mentioned at the beginning, the demand for education and for people to develop new skills, but also to support children around the world, you know, huge investments are needed in the public education system. Unfortunately, and very sadly, even before the pandemic, close to 70 million children did not go to school. Now, did have to do with, you know, there are no schools in the places where they had to go to school, or no teachers. But also, sometimes people have been living in a place where they have been exposed to war and other violence, and as a consequence, they could not go to school. So my point is that there's a huge growing need to educate children and students. And, you know, we do not have made the right investments globally to support all of this. Now, I believe that EdTech is obviously an very innovative, you know, platform for scaling education, for innovating, for equalization. So this is a, you know, a very important time for EdTech to play a bigger role even than it has played before. In terms of policies, let me start with a couple of examples. From a government perspective, many governments around the world, they need to step up and they need to provide more national or federal funding when it comes to upskilling, reskilling, but also when it comes to making sure that every child has access to education. Secondly, providing tax incentives for individuals to invest in learning and development. One of the trends that we see is that more and more people are paying for their own education, and particularly when it comes to a graduate degree, when it comes to executive education, when it comes to professional education, when it comes to technological training, that people are paying themselves. Because companies are not always paying for it, or when people are contractors, work for themselves, basically that's the only option. So make sure that, you know, people are incentivized from a tax system perspective. And third, you know, deploy policies in countries that will support the whole notion of lifelong learning, making sure that people are set up to be successful, that they can be redeployed at any time as needed. Then secondly, from a corporation perspective, organization perspective, I think that many organizations and a number of them are really aware of it. They need to double down the investments in learning and development because of the huge needs for employees to develop different competencies. Secondly, in the past, and I talk about, you know, 10, 15 years ago, in a lot of organizations, the focus was on developing only a small portion of the workforce, typically what have been referred to as the 1 or 2% of the talented people, the high potentials. And this is kind of, you know, has been shifting in a growing number of organizations. And my point is that, you know, if you really reflect on the talent definition, every person in an organization has talent. Every person needs to be developed, and therefore organizations need to embrace learning for all culture, making sure that every role is a development role and every person needs to be developed. And as part of that, it's key that people learn and develop. They acquire new expertise and develop new skills when doing their work. So that means that we need to make sure that, you know, we turn the workplace into a learning place. So making sure that people will learn something new every day. And then from an individual perspective, it's key that people realize, and you know, if I go back in terms of the people who are graduating this year from our institution and your institution, people are in their early 20s. They likely will work until their 70s or 71, 72, because pension plans have been pushed out around the world. And if lifespan, will become longer, people will work longer. But the only way to continue to work and add value in the workplace is to make sure that you are employable. And the only way to be employable is to make sure that you continue to learn new skills, develop new competencies. So people need to embrace a mindset of lifelong learning, and they need to also invest personal time and also financially in their own development. So I like to close where I started this today. I've mentioned that I have a foundation. It's called E-Learning for Kids. And this is a foundation I started almost 15 years ago. At that time, realizing that there are many children who can benefit from better education, more personalized education, and supplement that with classroom learning or homeschooling. And this portal, E-Learning for Kids, provides children around the world with free access to about 600 courses on math and on science. It's all game-based. It's we are using gamification techniques from a pedagogy perspective to make it a very powerful experience for children. Again, this is for children between 5 and 12 years old. And the curriculum that we have built is based on the International Baccalaureate Standards, and the IB is one of the most recognized curricula in primary and high school education. So if there's anything what I hope to that you walk away with today, hopefully, is that you, if you are in touch with a school or a teacher, please share the website. If you have children younger age, expose them to a math world or science world, and hopefully they will benefit from it. And with that, we are at the end of the presentation. And I will look at some of the questions that will be facilitated by Christina. I've mentioned that I've published a number of books. I just feature a few of them here. One is a book that was launched last year, and with my McKinsey colleagues, called Elevating L&D. Another book on the left side is about insights from positive leadership on leading change. And the book on the right side is a book, a personal book for people, is How Can You Advance Your Authentic Confidence, was published last year as well. So all the books, all the royalties for the books are donated to the E-Learning for Kids Foundation and to Save the Children. And with that, I have my LinkedIn here. If you want to connect, feel free to do so. I am sharing material on the website, and I will turn it over to Christina for facilitating the Q&A for today. And thank you for joining this session, and I hope that there are a couple of takeaways.
Thank you so much, Nick, for such an insightful presentation. And now, let's profit from the fact that we can see everybody's faces. So please, cameras on, if possible, and begin to share your questions and knowledge sharing on the chat. And I would like to start, if you allow me to, please.
Ask
you the first question, Nick. And this is it. You know, in your presentation, you pointed out that one on three European employees will have to upskill or reskill over the next 10 years. And EdTech will play a key role enabling this, but it cannot do it alone. Which could be the best way for EdTech companies or solutions to coordinate with the business priorities of their client companies?
Yeah. No, thanks, Christina. I think, and this also what's happening through, as an example, companies like Coursera, who have employees who are reaching out to the chief HR officers from large corporations, and together explore you know, what the key competency gaps are of people who are currently in the workforce. And obviously, a lot of work needs to be done by the CHROs from organizations when it comes to workforce planning, and basically looking ahead and say, okay, for the next 5 years, what do we know about roles that will disappear? What do we know about roles where, you know, let's say a 30-40% of upskilling is needed? What are the roles where we see an upskilling needed of 60-70%? And then what are the key competencies that people need to learn? What are the roles that will become obsolete? What are new roles that will become available in the organization? And then basically having a dialogue with employees about, okay, how to get ready for a new role or for an extended role or a role with different competencies, and to collaborate with edtech vendors to say, okay, we need more people, I make it up here, who understand data science, right? So, and analytics. So what kind of offerings can we pull together? Can we curate and offer to segments of our workforce so that our people can be educated, certified in those specific domains? So that's the long answer. The short answer is connecting with corporations on their specific needs, partnerships.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. We have a question from Alison Clark Wilson that is a very interested one about who defines blended. And also something that we have been talking about largely about tackling learning needs, which are the real learning needs that we can have either, for instance, in higher education or in corporate education, that we will have to begin or reinforce teaching to our students or to our employees, and how to know which are the needs and how to make them accessible. Reachable for them.
Yeah. So I would say it starts with looking at a number of existing reports on the future of work, you know, from different organizations like the World Economic Forum, the World Bank. This morning I got a report from MIT, but also consultancies like McKinsey, BCG. And basically look at, you know, what are some of the key themes actually in all these reports, right? So now they are based on a lot of, you know, research, studies, conversations with companies, but also it could help actually to check in with a couple of leading companies as well. IBM has also their point of view on what are future skills. So once you have kind of a sense of, okay, what will it look like for the next 5 years, then the question is, okay, from an education perspective, where are the gaps today? Now, on the gaps, I have a couple of thoughts on that. One is that, there are a lot of predictions that by 2025, 50% of all the work will be done by machines, 50%. Now, of course, the question is, will that be 55 or 48? Nobody knows. But the direction from all the research reports are very clear. We are going through a massive level of digitization, automation, robotization over the next 5-10 years. Then the question is, okay, what is the machine good at? Because what I believe is that as a human, we will never win it from the machine on tasks that the machine is outstanding at. So as an example, collecting and processing data, okay, machine win it always from us. We will never win it. Highly physical work, the machine can work for 50 years, humans cannot. When it comes to analyzing documents, okay, machine can do this 1,000 times faster than we can. So therefore, we need to ask ourselves the question, okay, what are the things that the machine will do? What are the things that we are, as humans, are great at, right? And this goes back to, you know, if I just refer to a couple of competency models, it goes back to the a number of cognitive competencies. You know, as an example, problem solving, critical thinking, innovation. It goes back to human competencies, and it has to do with emotional intelligence. It has to do with leading innovation. It has to do with being resilient and flexible, etc. then we have also have, you know, a key learning, right? So learning, learn to learn, and learn to unlearn is a critical competency. And then we have the digital competencies. You know, every single person, every role will require a level of digital proficiency in applications, in architecture, in products, etc. So that are the big themes. And then the question is, okay, how to make sure that we include that in building our curricula and providing executives or professionals or students with that specific experience.
Thank you very much. And are you ready for the next one? We have Andreas Müller asking something really, really interesting for us. That is, to put it in a context, after the pandemic, we can have like three choices: going back to teaching and learning the way we did it before. We can have a new local demand or even country demand on new solutions. Or is this the time for new international platforms, even for PPPs, for public and private partnerships, from an edtech perspective? Is this feasible?
Yeah, I think what we have seen when it comes to innovation in any industry is that once you move forward, you never move back. Mm-hmm. So therefore, I think what we have learned and what we are using today is here to stay. Now, of course, there are still, you know, experience gaps when it comes to using technology, when it comes to edtech, when it comes to content, etc. There are still gaps, actually, and that's also why we see a huge increase in VC money in edtech organizations. Now, I also believe, maybe Andreas, to your point, what you suggest is that, from a government perspective, from a global perspective, or from a European perspective, there are definitely huge opportunities to say, hey, you know what, we can have all kinds of local initiatives, but what if we launch more, initiatives which go beyond borders, and that could help from an economy of skill perspective. It could help from a funding perspective. So I definitely believe that there are opportunities to think beyond countries, beyond companies, and indeed, think about different kind of partnerships, public, private, that can be established.
Thank you so much. And I don't know, Unique, but I would like to listen to everybody here. So what about if we pose them a question to debate before we leave the session? And being this a session that is filled with experts about European policies, which could be, in your opinion, the way to reach a nice balance at the European Union between regulation and innovation? If we would like to reach this global arena, this public and private partnerships and edtech, but we at the same time work with the laws like GDPR and we take care of ethics and private policy things, how do we find the balance? So now is your turn. Any volunteer? Go ahead, Alison.
Okay. So, I mean, I think this all comes down to ethics, ultimately. And, you know, if you can go with regulation, and then that is very expensive. To take Nick's point about tax incentives for courses, suddenly courses need to be regulated, which courses can be tax exempt, which courses can't. So you inadvertently create systems that don't necessarily bring the goal that you want to achieve there. And so much in education is around being honest and open and humble about what things can achieve and what they can't achieve, because I think this is one of the real tensions we have in these in the way that the edtech industry works. Is to get funds, you have to say what you're going to do. You have to say what you will build, and who calls you to account for that? You know, ultimately, if things are profitable, people don't look so deeply at what the inadvertent consequences are on the systems. So we do need strong ethical bounds norms that mean that we don't, you know, GDPR shouldn't be needed in EdTech. You know, it should be quite clear where learners' data resides, who gives permissions for things. So, I mean, I think I would advocate more for principles and values that underpin the way that we work together. There's always, how do you police this? How do you ensure that people do what they say? But that goes back to Nick's point about learning cultures, because if we really have good learning cultures inside our institutions and our companies and our governments, we are open to learn, and we can just relax some of the facade and the barrier, because ultimately we want the same thing. We want improved access and quality to education, which is a real sort of societal goal. So I think it's something around principles and values, mm-hmm. and less about regulation and all of the things that eat our energies and money and don't mm-hmm. necessarily still take us where we want to get to.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Alison. Yeah.
Wim, I think you are okay.
Yeah, I think I'm along the same lines as what Alison is saying, but maybe from a different perspective. I think it's also related to what is the driving force for these innovations. Is it the technology? Is it the money? Is it the business opportunity? Is it capacity building? So all these different possible driving forces might also have an impact. And yeah, I agree with Alison that it's not about regulation. It is it's more about what is driving us. Why do we need this innovation? And how will we then make it happen, actually? And depending on the viewpoint that we take there, I think that the answers might be different. I mean, if the driving force is a business opportunity, that's totally different from if the driving force is a capacity building, for instance, development of human capital or so. I think that for me, that would be the answer, rather thinking in terms of what is my viewpoint on what is driving me to go for that innovation. Rather than regulating.
Okay, Andrea.
Thanks, Wim. Yeah.
Maybe I can quickly join into that one. What I like a lot in that argument is that education, in a way, also is an instrument. And when we think about what is it instrumental for, then so far there's a lot of ideas that education is something that brings us into work. And that's industrial understanding for a long, long time, or even the state understanding from the British education system. But now when we follow Nick's ideas on AI and on digitization, or if you take even Lovelock's partly dramatic proposals, how a world with AI might look like, then the question is maybe not more, what is it that qualifies us to get some work, but mm-hmm. what is it that we're going to do at large? If work is done by also, whether it's 48 or 52%, different story, but if it's such a huge part that will be taken over by robots and automated algorithms, then what is it that we get educated for? Mm-hmm. That is maybe an interesting question for any kind of regulation or a political system that's behind that. So where do we drive, and how do we take that educational propeller into that?
Yeah, and there is, thanks, Andrea. So there is an interesting book, you might be familiar with it. It's called A World Without Work from mm-hmm. Daniel Susskind. A fascinating book that will basically go back in time and shares, you know, what has happened with work over the years, and also mm-hmm. looking at the future, where, you know, there might be less work actually than you know, than we are used to, particularly with a growing population globally, etc. So and then it goes back to, yes, are we educating people for work, or are we mm-hmm. educating people for, you know, for life, right? So mm-hmm. or is it both?
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I would like to introduce another question. It's about a context, the geographical context. We have many players, like we have China as a giant, we have India with unicorns, we have US, and then we have the EU, the European Union. Can we not be aware of that? Or if we are developing ed tech solutions, or we if we are not keeping the pace with the rest of the players, on even in a cultural or ethics perspective or value perspective, that can affect. So what could be a good point to move for collaboration? How do you see it? How do you do it, Nick, with reaching 20 million children on a global foundation on EdTech?
Yeah, I think it's always about networks, it's about partnerships, it's about of course having a product that makes sense, right? So there are many things that come together, but I think that's kind of tremendous opportunities for partnerships around the world. That's what I believe.
Okay. So it's been an hour already. So thank you so much, everybody, for joining us today, for creating Milena, this student, amazing working student group at European level. Nick, thanks so much for sharing your knowledge with us today, and eager to see you some other time.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, Christian. Thank you, Nick.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks for joining the session today, and have a good rest of your day.
You too.
Okay, bye. Take care. Bye.
Thanks
to Christina and Milena.
Bye. Mm-hmm.